is everybody so concerned about ratings that they feel like they have to put this so-called ratings magnet on the program? Now, I personally, I have not followed Trump to see whether he's rated very well. But I think the fact that he has jumped into the arena of hosting a debate for the party that he favors, the Republicans, and there's very few people showing up. What does that tell you? The guy's a chump. Okay, he's another rich guy. Big deal. Big deal. But now he takes it a step further. He just cannot understand why President Obama doesn't call him, because he's got a big voice. Here it is.
You, Mr. Trump, recognize that the real problem was a lack of leadership. And so ultimately you didn't blame Little John or Meatloaf. You fired Gary Busey. And these are the kind of decisions that would keep me up at night.
So Trump has met President Obama. Now here's the Trumpster Cut 5.
I've never met him, actually.
Really?
I've never met him. I mean, there's the thing. Me or others, you would almost think, hey, call up the guy. You could see he's getting a little angry with the way you're running the country. Call up Trump. I have a big voice.
You got a big voice. President, you got a guy. When I met President Obama last night again, I should have said, hey, Trumpster's looking for you. Mike Papantonio, always a pleasure. Good to have you with us here on the Ed Schultz Radio Show. We got some serious issues going on out there, yet the carnival continues with the righties. How much attention do we pay to this, in your opinion?
Well, Mitt has some new material to use against the Newter. You know, the Newt's own sister gave us a little insight into how flawed Newt's character is by announcing that there's no way she can support him. Newt for president. Obviously, she knows him well. Here's what's really bothersome to me, Ed. This is what we're going to see more and more of. Newt's new attack on children is much more than the run-of-the-mill hate talk that we've grown accustomed to hearing from this moral misfit, this character misfit. I don't know if you followed it, but it dovetails with last week he was talking about Obama as the food stamp president with a food stamp policy. And it's clearly a return to the Lee Atwater attack formula where we divide America by race. But now Gingrich's words are very, very carefully chosen. When he tells us, and this is what he's saying this week, that poor children should work as janitors, that they can't work as janitors because the only kind of work that American kids understand is something that's illegal. I don't know if you followed this, but it's incredible. Newt's talking about, he's attacking these kids, he isn't talking about just any kids here. He's talking about black kids.
Sure
he's,
is.
He's talking
there
about the
a,
kids.
There is a racial lining to this. We're going to do a big segment on this tonight on the Ed Show. This is who Newt Gingrich is, and he's got a history of this guy.
Yeah, well, he's talking about kids that Obama supposedly is showering in food stamps because Obama is one of them, if you follow the logic on. And a vote for Newt is going to change all that. Newt's telling his feeble, old teabag supporters that young black lawless children are going to kill America. And understand that Newt grew up with Lee Atwater's race baiting. His playbook, Atwater's playbook, was under his arm. Newt's creating a racial scare campaign. It's no different than the one we saw Bush Sr. run with those Willie Horton ads, or Reagan run with his welfare queen attack. There's nothing new or original with this attack. Remember a vote for Dukakis was going to mean that a vote against the death penalty was going to come, and that wild-eyed criminal blacks were going to be set free to molest and rape our children. You know, that was vintage Atwater, Ed. That's what Newt grew up with on politically. If you look at the early versions of his contract with America, there was even suggestions like that there. Now, Newt's taken the argument to new heights. Here's the new height, Ed. Newt's new scare tactic isn't only a race division, it's a generational division. It's a generational divide. Not only are people who Newt needs to save us from now, not only are they black or brown, but they're 40 years younger than the average old decaying teabagger tooling around in a little rascal wheelchair with a Confederate flag draped over the back. That's the new attack. It's not just race, Ed. It's generational. Next, we're going to hear the Newt painting the picture that the kids in the street involved with the Occupy movement, that they're the ones that he's talking about that are on food stamps. They're the ones that are too lazy to work. They're the ones who are a danger to all of us. Not only are they stealing our hubcaps, stealing our stereos, but they're stealing our financial future. That's where all this is going. It's completely playing into the demographics of the old battle axe, worn out, crazy teabaggers, half of them brain dead and half of them nearly physically dead. That's what you're seeing here, and everybody's missing this damn story. They think it's just the old same old race bait. It's not. We've moved now to the generational divide, and that's where his attack is.
Cut nine, fellas. Here is Gingrich talking about the poor kids.
Really poor children in really poor neighborhoods have no habits of working and have nobody around them who works. They have no habit of, I do this and you give me cash, unless it's illegal. What if you paid them to work as the assistant librarian? So what if they became assistant janitors and their job was to mop the floor and clean the bathroom?
I mean, this is unbelievable. Mm. And I cannot believe how the Republicans have not stepped up and decried him for saying this garbage.
They won't. They won't, Ed. They won't. They have to solidify that. Look, it's demographics, demographics, demographics. You got the teabaggers. You bring over some independents on this issue. They're a little afraid of this new generational shift that's taking place. It's a dramatic shift. They're very, very afraid of the same thing, the old racial, the boogeymen that we always see the Republicans come to, and that is divide us on race with things like welfare queens, divide us on race on things like Willie Horton, and now add to that the people in the street, the people in the street, these kids in the street, they're dividing this country. That's where this is going. And I got
to
tell you,
he's tried to cover it up by saying that kids should not work in coal mines, kids shouldn't work in heavy industry. And of course, he suggested the hiring of 8 or 10 that could eliminate the need for 2 janitorial jobs per school. It's an attack on labor, number one.
Of course.
It demeans the people that are already doing that kind of work. And if you're dealing with cleanup, you know, it could be some toxic things involved. It could be cleaning materials that aren't as safe as they should be. I mean, there's all kinds of things.
Of course.
Here.
Yeah, his attack last week, well, you know, people are taking food stamp money so they can go to Hawaii.
Yeah.
I mean, this isn't – look, nothing happens with this guy unless he calls on the old things he learned from Lee Atwater. He learned at the foot of Lee Atwater, and we're going to start seeing it more and more. And I got to tell you, it's going to take hold.
So why are the Republicans quiet on this? And I want to say this. I'm not going to be quiet on it tonight. I think that this has got a real serious undercurrent of racism in it. And I think he continues to talk about this. And this is not about an internship. This is not about an apprentice. This is about poor kids doing something because they have no work habits. He is broad-brushed. Right. A socioeconomic portion of our society and said, damn it, put them to work.
Ed, as you go forward with it, watch the generational divide, too. It's part of it. I promise you it's part of it. The demographics divide with the teabaggers is phenomenal. I mean, it's just, if you're not over 65, you're not a teabagger. Yeah. And so that's part of it, too. But that scare tactic put together with what's happening in the street with the Occupy movement, you'll see all that coalesce. That's where all this is going. It's kind of like Pearl's the last book, Nixon Land. If you take a look at that book, Nixon Land, it is the whole idea was scare the hell out of people. When you have riffraff in the streets that are, you know, they're threatening democracy. Now all he's done is labeled the riffraff as black and brown and young.
Great to have you with us, Mike. Always a pleasure.
Thank you, Ed.